what you came for. Lightning strikes every time she moves. And everybody's watching her, but she's looking at you. So when was the last time you really thought about what you think? Or when was the last time you were actually caught thinking? Our keynote speaker is engaged in a lifelong quest to examine strategic thought. As fintech pioneer and founder of Goldleaf Technologies, he advanced payments for community financial institutions and helped them think about their role in providing critical services. Now his focus is on metacognition, or thinking about how we think. You may have read his articles in ABA and ICBA publications, experienced him teaching at banking and credit union schools, or maybe tuned into his popular YouTube videos. But today, he's here in person to share three digital key insights on how to overcome the numbing effect of routine, like my reading off this sheet of paper. effect of routine, please join me in welcoming international speaker, author, and serial entrepreneur and big thinker, David Peterson.
In order to overcome the challenge of changing service expectations and to capitalize on opportunities, the entire enterprise, you and your entire organization, must be open to... What? What is he doing? Is this what we're here to talk about? Is this what you guys want to hear, some professorial dissertation on innovation? That's crazy. We've got real challenges in our industry, and we're not going to solve them with a meme. So you know what? Let's just get real. Let's just have a conversation, because I believe that you have innovation in your grasp. All we've got to do is figure out how to close our fingers around it. Now, think with me. Think about a time that you had an idea. In your institution, you had an idea. Maybe it was a great idea, but you didn't act on it. You didn't follow up on it. Now, that probably happens more often than we're willing to admit. Maybe you were afraid you wouldn't get permission. Maybe you were concerned about all the bad things that could happen if something went wrong. Probably you remembered that no good deed goes unpunished. So we think about all of these negative things that could happen instead of embracing this opportunity to actually think creatively and grab a hold of innovation. Let me share with you about something that happened in 1989. Oh, I'm sorry, 1989. How many of you were 10 or under, not born in 1989? Quick show of hands. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Oh, great, half the room. Wonderful, okay. 1989, I'm literally 3 months into my employment at a small community financial institution in South Georgia. Now, in that year, the Federal Reserve released something called Fedline. And as it turns out, Fedline was sort of a cluster of things that you had to do to kind of make files get processed. You with me? Some of you remember. And so I had seen a number of errors take place, errors in omission, errors in duplication. And I'm like, this, we have got to fix this. And I decided that I could fix it. So I went to work on it, and this dinky little program that I created eliminated errors, eliminated wasted time, and most of all, it saved us money. Now, that thing, that innovation happened for two reasons. Number one, I was looking to innovate. I was looking for ways that I could eliminate waste, that I could figure out a procedure or some way that we could streamline operations. I was looking for it. But second and more important, my CEO expected me to innovate. He valued the fact that I was innovating. And because of those two factors, we were able to actually come up with something that was so amazingly breakthrough for its time. And I'll never forget, I was sitting in my office because Tom Kalina from the Federal Reserve came in. He saw my program. He said, hey, David, can I have a copy of that? Sure, on a 5 1/4-inch floppy. Some of you haven't seen them. They have them in the Smithsonian. You can go take a look at them there. So I forgot all about it. Sitting in my office, minding my own business, I get a call from upstate Georgia. Mr. Peterson, this is Sue from Swainsboro. We've got your program here, but we didn't get the documentation. And we have some enhancement requests. My program? My program? Well, let me just stand up a software company and get right on those requests for you, right? Well, the calls kept coming in. And we did stand up, Goldleaf Technologies. And 2,500 financial institutions later, we changed access for all community financial institutions. Now, if the first three times, Goldleaf was the fourth time that we had tried to stand up some type of additional thing to do out of our subsidiary. And Goldleaf was the fourth effort. And nowhere will history record those first three failures. But Goldleaf made a mark. And if I had failed, if I had decided that I was going to quit after that first failure, that big opportunity would have never happened. How about you? How about you? Have you had an opportunity to grab a hold of an innovation, do something truly innovative at your institution? You guys are so much smarter and way more experienced than I was. But you have to act. You have to take action in order to make innovation occur. Now, what I want to talk to you about today is something that I call metacognition, or thinking about how you think. And it's metacognition, this idea that we're going to be aware of opportunities when they come and perhaps seize that creative moment to do something radically different that will fix our procedures, streamline operations, better serve our members. There are three components I want to share with you today about metacognition. First, I want you to identify autopilot. Number two, I want you to incorporate something I call think time. And number three, I want you to initiate thoughtful response when you have an opportunity to. All right, let's dig into these and talk about them. Autopilot. David, what are you talking about? Autopilot. Well, as it turns out, you make about 35,000 decisions every day. Does that seem like a lot? Yeah. It's like, wait a minute, 35,000? Well, as it turns out, scientists say that about 90% of those are subconscious. Okay, well, that still leaves 3,500 decisions. It still sounds like a lot. You might be interested to know that researchers at Cornell University say we make 227 decisions every day about food. Oh, okay, now I see how it's gonna stack up, right? But the amazing thing is that the vast majority of the decisions that we make on a daily basis are made on autopilot. You see, your brain is two hemispheres. There's a left brain and there's a right brain. And that every day as you go about your work day and all these different things are happening and you're reacting to all the stimuli, your left brain is on autopilot. And it's just automatically jumping in and it's making decisions. Do you believe me? Do you think that's true? Let me try an experiment. I'm gonna try this. It's a big group here. I'm not sure if this is gonna work, but let me try this. First of all, I want you to do an audience response. So to get you tuned up, I wanna hear a whoop. Let's hear it. Okay, I think you guys can do better. One more time. Whoop. All right, now you're tuned up and ready. I'm gonna say this, and I want you to say it out loud. Spell this word with me. S-I-L-K. What does a cow drink? Okay. I'm sorry, Fran, did we say we had the group of bankers? These were the credit union folks here today, right? It's a trick, folks. It's a trick, right? So I conditioned your brain in using the word silk, and then I asked you what a cow drinks, and many of you said milk. But you know that cows drink water. Your brain is on autopilot. On autopilot, every day, the things that you do are many cases are being driven by these automated responses that you do without even thinking about them. Now, again, the left brain, analog, decisions, math, logic, the left brain, the ones in control, thinking about all of those things, all those procedures. Right brain, creative. Right brain is analog. Right? The right brain is really the one that gets a chance to get out there and really kind of let you truly be creative. But you know what? The left brain is like the kid in school that knew all the answers. As soon as the teacher asks a question, I know! That's the left brain. And as it turns out, the left brain doesn't ever let the right brain get a word in edgewise. Autopilot. Now, as it turns out, we're in the financial services industry, so we do a lot of things over and over and over again. And this creates what I call the numbing effect of routine. And it exacerbates, it makes this autopilot worse because we're kind of doing those same things. We know that step four comes after step three and step five comes after step four, and we're just sort of in that groove. We respond to stimulus with this thing that we've said 100 times before without even thinking about it. And we have to be aware. Let me give you this example. Back in 1979, I was a teenager, 18 years old, and I had grown up sailing with my dad. And my dad, by the time 1979 came around, had a 40-foot, two-masted schooner. And dozens of times, we lived in West Palm Beach in South Florida, we would sail over to the Bahamas. Dozens and dozens of times. All the time, I was doing this. I was a pretty popular guy in high school. Hey, you want to go to the Bahamas? Great, I've got a boat. Come on, let's go. And it's like, yeah, David's a cool guy. So we take off at nighttime because our sailboat's pretty slow. So powerboat, get over there in 2 hours. Sailboat takes 10 hours, so we want to get there in the morning. So we would always leave at night. We would always sail just a little bit south of east in order to account for the Gulf Stream. And in the morning, when the sun would come up, you would see the Bahama Islands, and you'd be like, oh my gosh, we're ready to start our idyllic Caribbean vacation. And on this particular voyage in 1979, the sun came up. We didn't see this. We saw this. And I have to tell you, because I had done this over and over again, and we knew every single time it always works. We always go the same direction. We always do the same heading. And so the thought that came to my head was, who moved the Bahamas? They were right here the last time we came 2 months ago. So we figured out that maybe we'd gone too far south. We were way off course. So we head northeast. Okay, we just go a little bit more. We'll reach the Bahamas. 6 hours later, we still don't see the Bahamas. But fortunately, there was this powerboat going by, and about three or four guys that were out there fishing. And we hail them, and we bring them over, and we say, hey, we're a little bit lost. We're not sure about our compass here. We believe that if we keep going in that direction, we'll hit West End, Bahamas. You ever see that look? Do you ever know when people are concerned, like they have a look that they... So these guys are like... So the one guy says, if you keep going in that direction, the next thing that you'll hit is England. What? Yeah. Turns out it's about 4,293 miles in that direction, but that's where we're going. We were way off course. So again, this, I will never forget that example of the fact that we were doing things the way that we thought they were always supposed to be done, and it never occurred to us that we weren't south of the Bahamas. We were already north. How many times do we make an assumption about where we are, about what's going on in a procedure, that we do this over and over and over again, that we can't possibly see that something's different, or seize on an opportunity to be innovative? Now, how are you going to identify autopilot? So you say, David, okay, I get it. I see it. What you're talking about, autopilot, what am I supposed to do about that? Here's one example. This is something that you can, you know, take back to your institution. You hire a new employee. They're probably going to be a millennial. I hope that you're hiring young people to come in and be a part of your credit union. You hire this young person, and of course, in our credit union, we have lots of procedures that we have to follow. So you're explaining to them all the procedures. You see, John, here's how you do step 3, and then step 4, and then step 5. And John raises his hand and says, why do we have to do step 4? Now, if you're in charge of training John, there are really only two ways that you can respond to that question. One way is to go, John, step 4 comes after step 3, and it's before step 5. This is how we do things here. Maybe you don't sound quite that harsh, but you kind of get the idea that you're basically saying, follow the procedures. The other way is to go, wait a minute. Why do we do step 4? Is it possible that step 4 was created at a time when step 4 was needed, was important, but is no longer? Let's actually take a look and see what step 4 is about. Maybe it turns out that step 4 is a regulatory requirement. Well, okay. Then you explain it to John. John understands. But there's two very important things at play there. One is when we stifle people's questions, particularly the younger people that you're hiring, they will not stay at your institution very long because they want their questions to be valued. They want to know that you're not just shutting them out. But it gives you an opportunity to truly look at your procedures and determine if there are things that you're doing that, quite frankly, are no longer necessary. Autopilot. We got to make sure we are understanding when we're in it. Incredibly important. Now, think time. If you get autopilot, if you sort of start understanding autopilot, you say, okay, now here's a place where we might have an opportunity for innovation. This is when think time comes in. Innovation starts with creativity. There really isn't anything innovative without a creative thought, the idea of thinking about how to challenge the status quo, about how to do something differently than you did it before, right? So in order for you to get to think time, you have to get in an open state of mind. I love Monty Python. All those people that raised their hands that said they were 10 and under, they were going, is that a snake? He's talking about a snake. Go look it up on YouTube. Monty Python is an incredibly brilliant and creative British troupe that put together some pretty zany stuff. And John Cleese was one of the main individuals from Monty Python. And John Cleese is inspirational to me because he's saying creativity is not a skill. It's not something that you go and learn. It's just a matter of being in an open mind. Do you know who the ultimate individuals in our society that are open and ultimately the most creative? Who are they? Children. Children. Go look at children playing in the playground. My granddaughter, Cora, picked up a stick and organized 10 kids, and they had a pirate ship, and she was the captain. Infinitely creative and could care less who was watching or what anyone thought about what they were doing, right? True creativity. How do we get that? How do we capture that, that open state of mind in our financial institutions? Well, turns out there are four conditions that have to be present in order for you to be creative. Ready? Number one, space. Number two, time. Number three, time. What? Number three, time. And number four, self-confidence. Let's quickly take a look at these. First of all, space. If you think about your office, your cube, your workspace, and suppose that you decided that you were going to be creative in that space, how does it happen? Does it ever happen? No, because if you're in your office, whatever space you have, what's going to happen? Phone's going to ring. You're going to get an email. Somebody's going to come by and say, hey, don't forget, that report's due at 2 o'clock. You're going to ought to have all of these distractions that are going to bother you in your space. So you got to get out of your office and go to some creative space. Hopefully you have a whimsical room, a place where you can just sort of let your left brain pick up and fiddle with things and be involved so that your right brain can get creative. But even if you just get out of your office and go to a conference room where you can't be bothered, you need space in order to get creative. Number two was time. You're going to have to allocate time to be creative. You know what that means? That means putting on your calendar time to think. Oh, I'm not joking. I'm saying on your Outlook, you're going to go in there and say from 11 o'clock to 12 o'clock, thinking. Oh, yeah. I guess David's thinking between 11 and 12 today. Put it on your calendar. And at 11 o'clock, what are you going to do? You're going to get up from your desk and you're going to go to whatever the space is, and from 11 to 12, you're now going to be creative. Time to be creative now. Okay. How many of you think that in the first minute when you get in that space, you're going to be creative? Maybe not. Maybe as soon as you get in there, all of a sudden you're thinking, oh my gosh, well, wait, I was supposed to pick up a gallon of milk on the way home, and then John was going to call me, and I was like, your brain is just a whirl. Calm down. Just wait. It might take 10 or 15 minutes for you to sort of get in that open state of mind and you start really kind of thinking about a particular problem. That's okay. Don't be frustrated. With practice, you'll get better and better at it, but allocate time to think. Put it on your calendar. Now, what was the third one? Wait, I can't remember. It was time. David, you said time twice. Yeah, because remember, the first time is allocating the time. The second time is using all of that time. So if we put on our calendar 11 to 12, we go in our space. And now we start letting all our minds settle, whatever. And then in the 15 minutes goes by, now we're really kind of thinking, we're ideating. And bang, we have an idea. Oh, eureka. And you know what most of us would do at that point? Let's go put it into action. Come on, let's go implement it right now. It's a mistake. We're so in a hurry that I got an idea. Come on, let's go make it happen. No, keep thinking. Keep iterating. Keep going. Because that first idea that you have, as you continue to think about it, you may what? Actually improve on it. That idea may actually spawn another idea, which could actually be better than the first idea. And so if you've allocated the time, use all of the time to think. John Cleese, in his autobiography, talking about writing sketches for Monty Python, wrote with Graham Chapman, one of the other Pythons. And he talked about that Graham Chapman's writing was far superior than his. He was always so sick that his writing wasn't as good as Graham's. But Graham and him would plan time, 11 to 12, they're going to go think of sketches. And Graham would think of a few sketches in the first 10, 15 minutes, and then he was out smoking his pipe at the pool while John was continuing to grind through and iterate on these ideas. And guess what? John's sketches were almost always more creative, more inventive, more wildly innovative than anything Graham created, even though Graham was superior to him as a writer. Use all available time. Fourth, self-confidence. There is nothing that stops creativity more than our being concerned about what somebody else thinks about our idea. And as we grow out of childhood and go into adulthood, we get ground into this idea that we are careful about what somebody else is going to think. And if I may be so bold, in the financial services industry, if I could use a baseball term, we don't swing for the fences. We don't try to hit home runs. We dink out singles. We bunt for singles. Because why? Because when you look at the people who hit all the home runs, what do they also lead the league in? Strikeouts. And we are deathly afraid of a strikeout. Don't make a mistake. Don't make an error. Don't embarrass someone. Right? So we grind ourselves into this little dinking out singles instead of trying things truly innovative. We have got to change that as we face the challenges that come ahead. Now, at the end of the day, when you go back and look at some of those Python sketches, if John Cleese hadn't done what he did, if he hadn't innovated in the way that I'm talking about with this think time, then we never would have gotten to see the fish slapping dance, or my favorite, the Ministry of Silly Walking. Go look it up, young people. It's on YouTube. How about that? How about if in your institution, when somebody comes in and asks to see a loan officer and you say, well, sure, I'll take you to see Mr. Smith, and you did, right? Why not? We have made our financial institution so unfun that who wants to come in there? You know how I know this is true? Watch a mother come in with three kids, and the kids are coming in, they're kids. What does she say? Really? Come on. We can't make our organizations a place that people desire not to go. We've got to start changing that dynamic. Now, let's suppose that you don't have a space, but you decide, I'm going to get into some think time. So what you do is you close your door, and you put your feet up on your desk, you put your hands behind your head, and you know, 15 minutes, you really start to get in creative mode. Now you're really thinking. But the problem is that your office is along a big, long row that's all glass. So, of course, all your coworkers are walking by, and your boss, and your boss's boss, and they see you in there, looks like this. What are they thinking? That slacker better get to work, right? Right? In other words, can you imagine, just think right now, if you're not the CEO and you told your boss, I'm sorry, I'm going to be tied up for the next hour thinking. What?
Johnson, we don't value thinking around here. We expect action. Get to work.
Somehow we have to reintroduce this of the value of thinking, because that creativity is what's going to allow us to be successful as we face these challenges. Finally, thoughtful response. Thoughtful response. What we do most often is we don't respond to things, we react. And there's a big difference between a reaction and a response. But again, partly because of autopilot, but also just because of our human nature, when something happens, when somebody says something, a certain stimuli happens, we react. We don't respond. When you react, you get what you get. When you respond, you have a much better chance of getting what you want. what kind of outcome are you looking for? And so we need to start thinking about responses, not reactions. Let me give you an example. You're out walking in the woods, just out for a little hike. You come into a clearing, and on the other side of the clearing, you see a big mother grizzly bear and three cubs. Now, after you soil yourself, you have really kind of two things that could happen. Our natural thing would be to react, right? So you come around the clearing and you see the bear and you do what? Ah! Which does what? Alerts the bear to your presence, who thinks that you're coming to attack her cubs, and she eats you for lunch. Just a little snack. Now, the other way would be a response. So you come around the corner, you see the bear, literally you have that little mini heart attack thing, but the bear doesn't immediately see you, so if you remain quiet, you can what? Back out, don't turn your back, back out and go around and live for another day. Reaction versus response. It's a big difference, right? Now, how does this play out in the financial institution? Well, let me give you an example. Let's suppose that a senior manager of an organization comes and he gathers all the people in that particular office around. He says, okay, we're gonna do some brainstorming. We're gonna come up with some ideas. So everybody, we really want you to put your thinking caps on. Come on, it's time to get some ideas. All right, here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna talk about how we can get more people coming to our branch location. Anybody, come on, anybody has an idea? And Jones is a little junior clerk, you know, from accounting or whatever, raises his hand, he goes, sir, I think we should put popcorn machines in the lobby. Manager looks at him, reaction. Jones, that's the stupidest idea I've ever heard of. Popcorn machines in the lobby? What do you think this is, a carnival? It'd smell up the whole lobby. That's a ridiculous idea. Okay, anybody, come on, give me an idea. Come on, ideas. Anybody. So Sue, she had an idea. What is she thinking? I don't know if my idea was any better than Jones. And he just squashed Jones like a bug. So the idea is that we have to get in this mode of not reacting, but responding. I was doing a strategic planning facilitation once and actually had somebody ask me, David, there really are stupid ideas. What are we supposed to say? I don't want to say, that's a great idea, if it's not a great idea. I said, no, I get it. Just give encouragement. Just give encouragement. That's an idea. I like the way you're thinking. Okay, get more. You don't have to give anybody false encouragement that their idea is ultimately good. And when you're brainstorming, just gather all the ideas. You can figure out later which ones are truly good. But you know what? If Jones gets squashed like a bug, he's not going to offer a second idea. And maybe his second idea was terrible. Maybe his fifth idea was absolutely rotten. Maybe his 12th idea was ridiculous. But the 20th idea, all of a sudden, is huge. It's just amazing. And when you squash people, when you stifle creativity by reacting and self-editing, you never get to that other idea. Never happens. I believe that innovation occurs at this intersection. It's the intersection at what is desirable by users, what is possible to do with technology, and what is viable in the marketplace. Where those things intersect, innovation is rampant. So what kinds of things? Would you say that mobile remote deposit capture meets that requirement? The intersection of what's desirable, what's possible, and what's viable? Sure, right? What are some of the other things then? What else is now falling into that intersection? What about the amazing work that Symitar is doing with Alexa and this whole idea of artificial intelligence? Doesn't that fall into that intersection where your members are going to be looking for you to provide them with that kind of functionality? I think so. I think so. But as I really start to think about this idea of what's the future hold, not what's going on right now, but what's that thing that you should probably have on your radar, not too far away? I think it might be this. Virtual reality. Augmented reality. Mixed reality. How many of you have actually put on and experienced full virtual reality? Some of you had the chance to do that right here at the conference, right? Did you guys see that one of the vendors, DBSI, had a virtual reality where they were showing off their product in a VR setting? Pretty cool. But I'm talking about going where you're actually playing one of these full immersion games. And I know you're from all over the country, but I encourage you, find a VR game room near you and go experience this for yourself. It is literally mind-changing about what this technology represents. My introduction to virtual reality was at Tennessee Tech University. Tennessee Tech, by the way, considers itself to be the Georgia Tech of Tennessee. So they're pretty into technical stuff there. So they have this iCube, and I go into the iCube, and I'm in this huge room with all of these sensors, and I put on this Oculus Rift headset, and I'm standing on top of a castle wall, and as I look down, I can see the courtyard 20 feet below me. And Dr. Thomas Paine, who's kind of walking me through, was talking about it. He said, look around, David. Can you see all the detail, whatever? And then he says, look, tell me how far down you think it is. I said, I don't know. It looks like it's probably 20 feet. He goes, it is 20 feet, and he pushed me. He literally pushed me. My friend, Thomas Paine, pushed me. And as I went over the ledge, I felt myself falling. I actually felt wind going up past my face. And I didn't crash to the ground like with broken legs, but I did one of the superhero landings. It's pretty cool. Obviously, it wasn't as cool to you as I thought it was, but it was kind of like a, you know, superman. Here's the thing. Is that my brain told me, and my body reacted to it as if it were real. Virtual reality. Now, the technology is changing. As you go in the future and look just a few months down the road, you know, you're going to have glasses that don't require a tether. You've got amazing technology now that's going to allow these to be very, very tiny and very, very powerful in terms of how the user is going to experience that. Don't have to have a big cable tethered back to a special computer. So what does that mean for you? What about your specific institution? How would virtual reality make a difference for you? Well, think about this. If we combine this idea of virtual reality, and we think about the people who most often use that technology are younger people, millennials and Minecrafters, we'll call that generation coming after them. And one of the things that those individuals don't seem to be as adept about is paying bills and managing their money. They just struggle with that. It's just not something that they really spend a lot of time doing. So what if we combine those things and you actually had the ability to help your members do this, right? So they're looking at this stack of bills and they just got paid and they look at your tablet application, okay, I got paid. And so they put on their virtual reality glasses, and now their payroll is a pizza, and all of their bills are avatars sitting around looking for their slice. Student loans, rent, and utilities, they don't wait, they take their slice, right? And so now this young person has the chance to sort of dole out his pizza slices as he budgets out and pays eating out groceries and allocates money for gaming. Oh, but oh, savings. Whoa, what about me? Come on. Are you kidding me? No love for me? And so now he has to make a choice. Well, okay, I'm going to reach over and take money away from gaming. Bang! And I'll save some money for another day. Right? So now the pizza's gone. He takes off the virtual reality headset, and he picks up his tablet from your financial institution, and lo and behold, everything's been budgeted, and all his bills have been paid. Crazy? Innovative? Creative? What's it going to take for you to think differently about what it means to be a financial institution and the customers and members who are coming who are going to avail themselves of your services? How can we think differently? How can we capture this idea that it's not an issue, it's not a problem if we're different? The only thing that's going to kill us is if we're just the same as everyone else. If we're just the same as everyone else. I believe that every one of you in here has the opportunity to take these three elements of metacognition that I've just talked to you about and seize them, embrace them, to grasp them and close your fingers around them. But everyone in this room falls into one of three categories. Everybody, every one of you. Either you're able to innovate, somebody's standing in your way, blocking you from innovating, or you're the roadblock. No, sir, you don't have to raise your hand. It's all right, it's personal. You can innovate, someone's standing in your way of innovating, or you're the roadblock. If you're in the first group, if you're able to innovate and you're not being innovative, what's stopping you? What's stopping you? There's nothing in your way. There's nobody stopping you from innovative. You get busy. And if you're the CEO here, you can make innovation rampant across your entire organization. If you're the roadblock, then stand aside. Maybe you can't help yourself but to rain on everyone's parade and talk about how that'll never work here. We tried that once 60 years ago and it's not going to work. Maybe that's okay. Maybe. But just stand aside and let people with dreams and creativity and innovation, just let them go. Just don't get in their way. Now, if you're in the third group where you really do want to innovate, but you don't really seem like you're getting the ability to do that from above. It's hard. I get it. I understand that it's easy for me to stand up here and say, oh, you should be innovative, when you're getting blocked at every turn. It's frustrating. But here's what you do. Start small. You control some little part of your organization. And if it doesn't cost money, you can innovate. You don't have to ask somebody to pay for something. You can innovate. So do that. So innovate where you can. Don't exaggerate small wins. Don't be, oh, look what I did. But be prepared to give an account about how your innovation is saving money or increasing the member experience. And then wash, rinse, and repeat. Do it again and do it again. Because small innovations lead to other small innovations, lead to medium innovations, lead to bigger innovations, and bigger innovations lead to transformational growth. Now, maybe, just maybe, some of you having hearing all this and ready to charge up the hill, okay, David, I'm ready, let's go, we're going to go innovate. But guess what? After a big party tonight, you're going to fly home, you're going to be in your credit union on Monday morning, and it'll take till about 10 o'clock for you to fall into the numbing effect of routine. Right? It's going to be so easy for you to lose this encouragement, this feeling of, yes, I can do this. Not we, I can do this. So I want to hold you to account. I'm going to check up on every one of you. And if I find out that you're not innovating, I'm going to contact you. I'm going to come to your institution. I'm going to hound you. And in that ridiculous professor announcer voice, I'm going to come after you. Jim, I understand that you have not been setting aside time for thinking. I will hound you. All of you have this capability. Your friends at Symitar are going to help you all along the way. All you have to do is take the first step. I would say 10 minutes from now would be a good time to start. Thank you all very much. Love it. Thank you.